Well, we're going to pick up Luke 18 at verse 31. And as a reminder of the very previous verses, we looked at them last week, of course, this rich young ruler who came to Jesus and then went away sorrowful. He refused the Lord's command on his life. And it led to Peter pointing out to Jesus that he and the other apostles had left all their possessions and left their families at home to follow Jesus. And Jesus had encouraged that they would certainly be blessed, both in this life and, of course, in the life to come. But the disciples here are still in a place of somewhat misunderstanding some things. You know, this is still the time when they're asking Jesus about sitting at his right hand in the kingdom and all. And so Jesus takes them aside to again lay out what his mission on earth is all about. So that's where we pick up at verse 31, looking at the mission of Jesus. Verse 31, then he took the 12 aside, so the 12 apostles there, and he said to them, behold, we are going up to Jerusalem, and all things that are written by the prophets concerning the Son of Man will be accomplished. For he will be delivered to the Gentiles, and will be mocked and insulted and spit upon. They will scourge him and kill him, and the third day he will rise again. But they understood none of these things. This saying was hidden from them, and they did not know the things which were spoken. So, Jesus is on the road to Jerusalem, the final days of the ministry leading to the cross. And it's interesting to see the two perspectives here. First, we have Jesus, full understanding of what's going on, what the future holds, understanding this is God's plan. And of course, he is submitted to that plan. Understanding that this is what the scriptures foretold, that everything is working out just as God had it written down in what we call the Old Testament about the Messiah's rejection, how he'd be shamefully treated. He'd be whipped, and yes, he would even be killed. But you notice when Jesus does talk to the apostles about this, he also adds, and the third day he will rise again. It's not going to end in the grave. And of course, by the way, the Old Testament scriptures also prophesied the resurrection as well. So we have on the one hand Jesus with that full understanding, and then we have the disciples, and they don't understand it at all, do they? Now, the disciples had the same scriptures that Jesus is referencing. They knew the prophet Isaiah, and they knew the Psalms, but they didn't understand what God's word was saying. And it's a reminder that is emphasized throughout the Bible that we need the Holy Spirit of God to truly understand God's word. Paul makes this point in his letter to the Corinthians. He talks about a natural man born in his natural state, sinner by nature, without God's Spirit. He's never been born again, never been converted. How that natural man cannot understand the spiritual truths of God. Now, of course, it doesn't mean he can't read the words on the page. And how many times do you run into someone who doesn't know the Lord and says, well, you know, I've read the Bible. But that's not the point, just simply reading the words. It's understanding the message that God is teaching. That's why the only true message to the unbeliever is the gospel. Jesus died for your sins and you need to receive him. He rose from the dead for your forgiveness. Call on Jesus as your Savior. Don't start arguing with me about, well, you know, I've read about shellfish and get into all these things about how stupid us Christians are with our beliefs when you don't even have the slightest clue of what you're talking about. You can't possibly understand things like context and dispensations and the rest of the scripture. You need Jesus. You need to receive the gospel, humble yourself at the cross, and be saved. And at that moment, the Holy Spirit will indwell you, and then God's word will come alive. It's like if you've ever read a confusing poem, like, what is this poem all about? Well, if you had opportunity to actually speak to the author of the poem, the poet who actually wrote that poem, and that author could explain to you, this is what I was trying to say, this is what the symbolism means that you're finding confusing, whatever, well, then you'd understand the poem, wouldn't you? And can you imagine someone coming along who's never talked to you all and says, no, that's not what it means. Here's what it means. You'd say, man, I just spoke to the poet. I know what I'm talking about. You don't. We need God's Spirit. At this point, of course, we're before the birth of the church. We're before Acts 2. We're before the indwelling of the Holy Spirit upon these disciples. They don't understand. They had the same scriptures. Same thing that Jesus is talking about. It was all foretold in the scriptures, but they don't get it. They don't get how the Messiah is going to be rejected and killed. And then he says, but I'll rise again. It's as if it just doesn't register. Now, there's another point to be made here, and that sometimes comes up when people say, well, then how come so many Christians, who all have the Holy Spirit that you're talking about, Steve, how come they have different views on the Bible? Well, it's because some are wrong and some are right. Now, I don't mean to be arrogant, because we all think that we're right in our understanding of the Scripture and how we teach it. But God is the teacher of the Scripture, and God is in control. And you notice how it says, not only did they not understand it, but the saying was hidden from them. If you're familiar with the book of Daniel, in the last chapter of Daniel, as he's getting all of these prophecies and this vision and all this right now, he gets to a point where he gets confused about some of the stuff he's writing about the end times. And he asks for some understanding, and the response back is, just write it down and seal it up. Daniel, I'm not going to explain it to you. Now, God is God. He can do that. Because he says, it doesn't concern you, Daniel. I want you to write it down. I want it to be part of the prophetic word, but it's for the end times. And you know what? In those days, the knowledge will increase. And I believe that speaks of a knowledge of the word of God, especially the prophetic word about the last days. So if you run into a Christian, faithful, devout believer in Jesus Christ, filled with the Holy Spirit of God, but maybe as part of a church denomination whose founder lived 400 years ago, is it possible that the founder didn't have 100% understanding, no matter how great the man might have been and how God used him, may not have had full understanding of all the details of the scriptures, for example, of the last days? Because maybe God and his sovereignty just didn't share all those details. A lot of people say, well, you know, what some of you guys believe is going to happen before Jesus returns, you know, that's relatively new teaching. That's only been around 100 years or so. Well, maybe that's a sign that we're getting close. And knowledge is increasing, just like God said it would. Newness should not be an excuse to throw out what seems to be pretty clear understanding of the Scripture. God has his plan laid out in Scripture, unfolding. A lot of details about the first coming of Jesus, all fulfilled. A lot of details about what the world's going to be like at the second coming of Jesus. And I guarantee you, they're all going to be fulfilled as well. And of course, once they're all fulfilled, we'll all be able to look back and say, ah, I see it now. There may be some question marks in between. For example, it certainly seems to me, as I study the Scripture, that the Middle East, specifically Israel and the city of Jerusalem, is going to be very involved in world history when the Lord returns. Well, for over 1,800 years or more, there wasn't a whole lot going on in Israel and Jerusalem as the gospel spread throughout the world. But boy, the last 60, 70 years, it's been a different story, hasn't it? Even to the present day. Now, I've said many times, we have to be careful about newspaper prophecy, where there's a little action going on in Israel and people are shooting rockets at each other and everyone says, the scripture's being fulfilled in front of our very eyes. It's like, well, which verse? When you say the scripture's fulfilled, you got to point me to chapter and verse. So we got to be careful because they've been shooting rockets at each other for quite a while. Decades, in fact. But what we do believe, at least I do, and I believe many of you do, is we're seeing that slow forward progress towards the culmination of God's plan over there, don't we? That's what we're seeing. But you see, the world doesn't understand our perspective. As Christians, when we pay attention to events over there and we try to talk to people about it, sometimes the response is, are you guys looking for war? Are you excited about people dying from rocket blast? And of course, that's ridiculous. No Christian is excitedly looking for people to die from rocket blasts. If you do, repent. But it's like the Apostle John in Revelation. As God was unfolding the plan in the last days, and how he was given God's word, told to eat it. Revelation, a very symbolic, fascinating book. And as he consumed God's word, it was sweet in his mouth like honey, but it was bitter to his stomach. And you see, and that's what we're talking about. Because when we're talking about the return of Jesus Christ, and the fact that it may be soon, well, that's sweet to our mouth, isn't it? We get excited. Praise the Lord. Maranatha. Sweet like honey to the mouth, but what's going to happen when the Lord returns? Well, we know that with the Lord's return is a judgment upon this world, the damnation of souls to hell. And that's very bitter in our stomach, isn't it? We're not rooting for the destruction. We're not rooting for the death and the chaos and the damnation. We are rooting for the Lord to return, but it's a package deal because we know what accompanies the Lord's return. But you see, to the unbelieving world, there isn't that understanding. And you can point to the verses and they still won't get it or understand where you're coming from. But God's word is going to be fulfilled. All of it. Now let me tell you another aspect of God's word that's going to be fulfilled. Much like Jesus said, all the things about me are going to be fulfilled. I'm going to be rejected, spit upon, whipped, killed. Well, the Bible has some things to say about us, those of us who follow Jesus Christ. The Bible says that we're going to be hated by all people because of Jesus' sake. Not because we bring it on ourselves, because we're jerks. We're hated simply by identifying with Christ. Simply by saying, this is God's word, this is our authority for life and faith, and that alone will bring hatred. That's God's word. It's going to be fulfilled. Do you feel hated today? If not, I can point you to a couple websites and you'll find out that you are hated by many of your fellow Americans. Simply because of your faith in Jesus Christ. Simply because of what you believe about God's word. It's kind of interesting to me, given the fact that we just had the election, and I read a lot of the political articles, and I read from Democrat sites, and I read from Republican sites, and I realize, man, I'm hated by both sides. I read Democrat sites and how these Bible-believing Christians are screwing up the country, and I read Republican sites that these Bible-believing Christians are costing us elections, and wow. well, I guess this is not where our earthly kingdom's supposed to be then, huh? The Bible says that all who live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. Now, maybe the freedoms that we enjoy in this country are such that the persecutions that we experience may be less than what other brothers and sisters in Christ might face in, say, Egypt, Syria, North Korea, China, or elsewhere. But hatred and persecution is still hatred and persecution. Maybe like me, you get upset at the double standard in our country. How Christianity, our Lord Jesus Christ, and his followers can be blasphemed, can be mocked in movies and television and by journalists. And, well, you know, freedom of expression, free speech, freedom of the press, you know how it goes. And yet, if someone dare criticize or mock Islam, Muhammad, his followers, well, we see riots break out. We see violence. People burning buildings. People actually putting other people to death. Hits called out on writers and cartoonists who dare mock Islam or Muhammad. And does the world say, well, you know, freedom of expression, free speech? They say, no, you guys got to stop that. Come on, be sensitive to people's religious beliefs. This is appalling. This isn't what... And he said, well, what about the Christians over there? And the double standard. Isn't it? Now, why does that grieve you? And why do you see that double standard? Because as a follower of Christ, you have the mind of Christ. And one of the attributes of Christ is what? Justice. Equality. Not being a respecter of persons. You realize that's not fair. If you're going to allow one religion to be mocked, then you ought to allow all of them to be mocked. And if you're going to defend one, you ought to defend them all. And not play a double standard. Because as having the mind of Christ, you understand justice and equality. And maybe in your flesh you say, maybe we ought to burn a few buildings down and get upset. Let people know us. But then, as I said, in your flesh you might think that, but you realize, no, that's not what a follower of Christ does. And you really don't have a desire to do that. You don't want to go out and act like what we see on the evening news. And why don't you want to act like that? Because you have the mind of Christ, and Christ is good. And so you want to do what is good, and not what is evil. But it's a sign of the times in which we live. God's word being played out. Just as it was 2,000 years ago in Jesus' day as he was on his way to Jerusalem. So the mission of Jesus, again, emphasized for the disciples. And now we have an example of the mercy of Jesus shown to us here, starting at verse 35. Then it happened as he was coming near Jericho that a certain blind man sat by the road begging. And hearing a multitude passing by, he asked what it meant. So they told him that Jesus of Nazareth was passing by. And he cried out, saying, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. Then those who went before warned him that he should be quiet, but he cried out all the more, Son of David, have mercy on me. So Jesus stood still and commanded him to be brought to him. So let's picture that scene. He's coming near the city of Jericho. Now, right there, it's interesting. Remember, we talked about the unbelieving skeptic who likes to explain how bad our Bible is. For years, people were critical, thinking there was a contradiction in the Bible, because here we read that Jesus is on his way to Jericho when he encounters a blind man. But the other Gospels have him coming out of Jericho. So, contradiction. See, you guys are silly with your beliefs that this is God's word. Now, you might say, well, that's not that big a deal, is it? But actually, it is a big deal. The Bible doesn't have any mistakes. What we understand is that there was a city of Jericho in Jesus' day, populated and all that. That's where he was headed. There was also an ancient, uninhabited city of Jericho in ruins about a mile or so away, from which he had just departed. Yes, he could be leaving Jericho and going into Jericho at the same time. No contradiction whatsoever. in fact, perfect accuracy, especially when you look at which gospel writer emphasizes which city. But that's just an aside. We have this blind man. This is probably his spot. You know, you on the road, there's some traffic, people are going to Jerusalem, they're going to worship God, hopefully they're in a generous, giving spirit, and you're begging for your survival. And you're used to, you hear, you can't see, but you hear, you know the normal sounds of the day, but you've got this huge crowd coming. This is much more noise than you're used to hearing. And so you ask some people, say, what is going on? And they explain, Jesus of Nazareth is passing by. Now, can anything good come out of Nazareth? Remember, there weren't a lot of celebrities from Nazareth, and Jesus may have been a relatively common name at his birth, but Jesus of Nazareth could only mean one person. And this blind man knew exactly who that was, the one he's been hearing about for 3 years or so. The one he knows has been doing miracles throughout the land. And the one he knows is the Messiah. So when he calls out to him, he doesn't say, Jesus of Nazareth, have mercy on me. What does he say? Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. Son of David is a title for the Messiah. A special messianic title. Now Luke, in the earliest chapters when we were studying the birth of Jesus, makes a lot about the fact that Jesus is a descendant of David, that the right to David's throne is his, and that is emphasized in those early birth chapters. But then throughout Luke's gospel, we haven't seen Son of David at all until here, a blind beggar making that proclamation to the crowds. So again, picture the scene. No doubt, here's Jesus, and he's surrounded by people. So there's crowds in front of him, probably crowds behind him, crowds on the side. And so the early wave of crowd comes in, and that's when the blind goes, what's going on? And they explain to him, and he begins to cry out and cry out. And they begin to try to keep him quiet. Notice those who went before were trying to, and the idea is repeatedly, get him to shut up. But he just keeps crying out more and more. Son of David, have mercy on me. There's always those in the crowd who are going to try to keep you from Jesus. So don't think that Jesus has ignored him or any such thing. It's just by the time that Jesus gets there, the front crowd's already gone by, and now he's there and he can hear him. He stops. Bring that man to me. And that's what they do. So let's pick it up there. I was halfway through verse 40. And when he had come near, he asked him, saying, what do you want me to do for you? He said, Lord, that I may receive my sight. Then Jesus said to him, receive your sight. Your faith has made you well. And immediately he received his sight, and he followed him, glorifying God. And all the people, when they saw it, gave praise to God. Remember, this blind man knows that Jesus is the Messiah. Son of David, Son of David. You remember when we began the Gospel of Luke and we looked at Jesus' earthly ministry, how it began in the synagogue of his hometown in Nazareth. And he got the scroll of Isaiah and he found the place in Isaiah where it was written, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me to heal the brokenhearted and preach the gospel to the poor and set the captives free and what? Give sight to the blind. And Jesus said, today the scripture is fulfilled in your ears. In other words, I'm the Messiah. I've arrived, just as Isaiah predicted. Of course, the people of Nazareth didn't receive him as such. They rejected him. But you see, restoring sight to the blind was actually a ministry sign of the Messiah. I mean, it's an incredible miracle. We recognize that, but it's even more than that. It's specific. It's a specific thing that the Messiah would do. So when this blind man who recognizes Jesus the Messiah, when he says, I want you to restore my sight, it's not in the sense of, you know, I have this healing I need, and in my case it's blindness. Although that is certainly his need, but there's also a connection there. You're the Messiah, and this is no problem for you. Now think about that for a second. Imagine restoring sight to a blind man, no problem for you. And of course it isn't any problem. And when Jesus says your faith has healed you, again, I believe it's far more than just simply thinking, oh, you can heal me, but you know who I am. And I will validate your faith here by healing you so the whole crowd can see as well. And they all did, and they all glorified God. And the beggar, now no longer blind, still poor, he followed Jesus on the way to Jerusalem. Now, it would have been nice if we had either more time last week, or I knew we would have more time this week, to put the encounter we saw last Sunday in the same message as this one, because Luke certainly does. As you're reading through Luke, you notice these are basically back to back. The rich young ruler, who also cried out to Jesus. Now, because he could see, he actually ran and met Jesus. But he went to Jesus with his request for eternal life. And we looked at all that last week. And you remember the end result was the rich young ruler went away sorrowful. He refused to heed the Lord's command on his life. Now, he went away sorrowful. He was still rich, wasn't he? He was still young. Still a ruler. But he really had nothing. This man, a poor beggar, now has everything, doesn't he? See, it doesn't matter what earthly riches, what earthly advantages like youth or looks or family or education. It doesn't matter what earthly power and authority over others one might have if one does not have Jesus. And the flip side, doesn't matter how little riches or power or advantages you have, if you have Jesus, you have everything. Someone says, well, I guess only the poor people get Jesus. No, we're not done, although we're done for today. Next Sunday, when we start the new chapter, and again, these are all back to back, aren't they? We're going to see a rich man, a guy by the name of Zacchaeus. And we're going to see that salvation could come to his house as well. Because he actually repented, unlike the rich young ruler. Zacchaeus repented. If any of you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ today, now is the time to call upon his name. Again, I don't begin to try to predict when the Lord will return. He truly may not come back for years and years, and all of us in this room may die our natural deaths before he does. That's possible. It is also possible he may come back tonight. But one day he will come back, of that I can assure you. And even if we do die our natural deaths, then will still appear before him. And that's why now is the time of salvation. That we might be found in him, resting in Jesus, trusting in him. Now, I know what you might be thinking after hearing this message and all this stuff about the world hating you and persecution and all that. Why would I want this? Well, the world may hate you, but God loves you. God loves you. God created you. God is working a plan not only in this world but in each one of our lives. And the bottom line is, the only one we're going to have to answer to one day is God. Not anyone in this world. Not your boss. Not our Congress. Not the UN. Nobody. But the Lord. And we will all answer to him. It's about what's true, not what's convenient or easy. What's true. And the truth is also this: whether persecuted and hated by the world, walking in the Spirit of the Lord, in the power of the Lord, is greater than anything this world offers you. Take it from one who knows. Take it from one who's experienced both sides. So now's the time to trust in Jesus as your Savior. To be looking to Him as the one who died for your sins and rose from the dead for you. And to say, Jesus, save me. I need you. It's a gift of God's grace available to all of us. And most of the people in this room have accepted that gift of God's grace. I realize that. And so for all of us, myself included, may I suggest that now's the time to be serious about our walk. Are these not serious days in which we live? Do you think the Christians in Egypt are serious these days? Do you think the Christians in Syria and North Korea and China, those other nations I mentioned earlier, do you think they're serious about their faith? I bet they are. Now's the time for us to be serious about seeking God and His will and to take a stand for the truth. Take a stand for what's right. Like the old saying goes, if Christianity became a crime in the United States, would there be enough evidence to arrest you? Hope you can answer yes to that. Hope you're living for the Lord today and every day. If not, that's step one. Lord, forgive me for my apathy, for being lukewarm. I want to be on fire for you, Lord. He'll forgive you like that. It's all under the blood. And then He'll put you in motion. And He'll guide and direct your path day by day according to His will as He unfolds the plan of time, the plan of history before our eyes. Let's pray.